that will be included in the midterm. So because on Monday we'll have a midterm, and then after that we will move on to the second part of the class. And everything that is after the midterm will be in the final. The final is not cumulative. Sometimes I add bonus questions in the final that pertain to the first part of the class. If you get them, that's great. If not, it doesn't matter if you have bonus questions anyway. So that's about it. Yes? Yeah, so I think that someone asked me that. I'm going to try to do that until the end of on the website. Yeah. With some sort of sample questions. Yes, I'm sorry. You need to bring a scantron, those ones that are pinkish, reddish ones. Yeah, it's going to be multiple choice. So you need to bring a scantron. And I have a few extra ones because some of you will forget them. You need to bring the scantrons, that would be great. Usually it's out of 40 questions. So the one that has, yeah, it's a full sheet. It's like the one that is like this, and it's pink. There is a green one and a pink one. If there is another question. Good. So today we are going to. Today is kind of a shortish lecture. So there is another lecture on genomics that goes into greater detail about the latest advances in genomics and stuff like that. So today instead there is a number of things that are almost like historical. I always struggle in wondering if even talking about it or not, because it's not fully relevant to what is going on right now in the field. At the same time, understanding a little bit where we came from as a field is interesting because it explains how the ideas developed. So there is going to be a little bit of that. Molecular evolution is a little bit different than evolution itself. So you can use molecular biology to understand regular evolution. That's great. But this is not exactly what I'm going to talk about today. Today what I'm going to talk about instead is what is somewhat peculiar to molecular evolution. There is a part of evolution that is only, relevant to molecules. And actually it's unrelated, disassociated from phenotypic evolution or behavior or ecology or things like that. Following this idea, there are many aspects, but today we will be talking about four different aspects of what is somewhat characteristic of molecular evolution. There is a C-value paradox. There is a molecular evolution is decoupled from morphological evolution. I will be talking about molecular clocks and the neutral theory evolution. The neutral theory is exclusively pertinent to molecular evolution. And it's a huge field in itself, and I will just talk about a few things away from that. Has anyone that has not taken my classes before heard of the C-value paradox before? Does anyone know what this is? So the idea of the C-value, what is the C-value for? Anyone knows what the C-value is? This is super important, this is great. I love it when you get to wake up in the morning and learn something. So the idea, this was not a very long time ago. So what you do is that you grind some cells, and then this is a glass tube. And you actually are shooting cells, single cells, through the tube. And actually here, there is a thing that counts how many cells went through the tube. and you shoot hundreds of them. The reason why you grind them here is just to separate cells, separate tissues into separate cells. And here, you send UV light at 260 nanometers. UV light at 260 nanometers is absorbed by DNA. And here you have a cell receptor, a photocell receptor, that can distinguish how much light came in this way and how much light arrives in the cell. And the difference is what is absorbed by the DNA. And because you're shooting hundreds of cells, you can end up with a very, very precise ratio between the number of cells and how much DNA went through this thing. This is some sort of a chamber here. And when you do the ratio, you actually can determine how much DNA is in each cell. This has been done a very long time ago. This was done in the 60s and the 70s. This is a very, very long time ago. People could do that. And eventually people, because cells are divided, it's not completely trivial. Because if all the cells were just at a stage where we think cells are, then you just do a division, it's simple enough. The problem is that cells constantly divide and replicate, and so it's not completely trivial because at different stages of replication, the amount of DNA in the cell is not exactly the same. But if you do that with enough cells, you can figure it out. Anyway, the amount of DNA that is in a cell is called the C value. And the C value in the old days was given in picograms. Picograms is 10 to the minus 12 grams because a cell has pretty much 1 to 3 to 4 picograms per cell. So it's a good number. Yeah.
Sorry, I was trying to write it all down. So the C value itself is how much light the cell absorbs?
No, C stands for cell, and the C value is a number that is given in picograms, so it's a weight, and it's how much DNA is present in each cell. That's what C value is. So C value for human is 3 picograms, give or take, and you can have 10 or 1 or whatever. So it's a number, the C value is a number that gives how much DNA is in a cell. Bit of a pet peeve of mine. When Bill Clinton decided to spend $10 billion to sequence the human genome, which I think was a great initiative, incidentally, eventually the people that sequenced the DNA had to justify having spent so much money. And so they said, "Oh, this is really incredible. We found that there is that much DNA in a cell because now we have the entire genome." We knew it from the 60s. Very, very precisely. The number was exactly the same. Because as simple as this method is, and this method is no different than what I just explained, there's nothing else to it. But you know, if you shoot 5,000 cells, you know exactly how much DNA is divided. The number that you obtain is very precise. And when you sequence it, it's also precise, but no more precise than this. And sure enough, the numbers were exactly the same. In any case, the C value is the amount of DNA that is in a cell. However, what we are talking about in the context of molecular evolution is not the C value. What we're going to talk about right now is the C value paradox. There is a paradox. Does anyone know what the paradox is? Kind of. The answer was simpler things have more DNA than we do. That's true, but a more general statement is the amount of DNA that is in a cell is not related with its complexity. So if you don't need to remember the numbers, I think that what I would like you to remember is just the nature of the paradox. So just to give you an idea, you start with diatoms, and because now we are actually sequencing genomes instead of doing this, then it's given as KBs. One mole of a base pair is 660 grams. Just kind of a cool number to know. And it's usually asked at some trivia, Wednesday trivia at the pizza place. But Diatom, 35,000 kVs. Drosophila, 180 kilobase pairs. That's the size of the genome. And then you just keep going. So a chicken is 1.2, a carp 1.7, snake 2.1, rats 2.9, human is 3.4. 3.4 gigs is the size of our genome. 3.4 gigabases. And so that's great, it's getting more and more. But then after that, you have the locust that is 3 times more than us. So we feel bad because locusts are way better than we are. And then you have onion and beetle and fern, and amoeba has a lot of DNA. So that's exactly what you were saying, you were right. That is that some genomes are huge, and we consider that they are not as sophisticated as we are. So there's a paradox, because these organisms have more DNA than we do. Now, if you look at the number of genes and the complexity of genes, the number of genes instead are more or less the same. We have, in humans, give or take, have about 25,000 genes, which is not that many. And so does Drosophila, pretty much. Because what we do and what Drosophila does is very similar as far as everything is concerned. So it's about 25,000 genes. So does anyone know how this paradox is solved? I mean, the answer is pretty obvious, but why is there no relationship between complexity and amount of DNA? I'm asking a super, it's so simple. Go ahead.
Because not all regions of DNA actually code for genes?
Yes, I mean, I was asking, yeah, absolutely. And not only, but in the case of humans, it's less than 5% of the DNA encodes for genes. So most of the DNA is non-coding, and it's an intergenic region. Usually the genome is represented like this. It's represented something like this, where genes are represented as boxes and intergenic regions are just lines. That's the same thing as DNA, but oftentimes people represent genes like this. And this is not to scale. If you were to do it to scale, you would have a box here and the next one would be at the end of the room over there, because these boxes only represent in humans 3.8% of the genome. This is really fundamental, because when, I don't know if any of you have studied, for example, the lactose operon, when people started studying DNA function in bacteria, but in bacteria, genes are right next to each other. There is no introns, there is no intergenic regions for the most part. And so people thought that vertebrate DNA was the same, where you have a bunch of genes. That's absolutely not the case. It's the way the genome is organized in multicellular organisms is very, very different. You have a lot of intergenic regions. And in the case of amoeba, it's even more so. Amoeba have less genes than us, and instead there's a lot of DNA. What this DNA is to this day a matter of debate. And so some people call it selfish DNA, some people call it junk DNA, some people call it chromatin that is extremely important under selection. Most people say that it's absolutely not under selection. You know, it's on and on. There is a huge field that is interested in just that part. But just to give you an example of one thing that is important, in a nucleus, this is the nucleus of the cell here, around here, the DNA is like this, but oftentimes genes that are related functionally might be physically close to each other. So you would have a gene here and a gene here. They're really far from each other, but because the intergenic regions are very, very large, they can then be folded back and be right next to each other. So when they are expressed, the RNAs that are expressed from those things happen to be physically near each other. So that's one of the functions, as an example. There is a lot of other things. I could talk for hours and hours about this aspect. So C-body paradox is not related with phenotype. for the most part. And it's just unique to DNA. Another thing that I want to mention that is really important. If you remember what I said on Monday, most mutations are deleterious. They are bad mutations. You don't want them. Now, the reason why we have one of the explanations for having a lot of intergenic region that does not encode for proteins is because most of the mutations would be in areas that are not going to affect our phenotype and so will not have an effect on our fitness. So it's actually good to have, so it's sort of like when you have a shower of bad things happening on us, if genes are rare, the chance to be rained on by a mutation is very small, which is a good thing. The second aspect is molecular evolution is sometimes decoupled from morphological evolution. There is nothing much to say about it, except that the classic thing that you would expect is that when morphological similarity is low, you are expecting genetic similarity to be low as well. And when morphological similarity is high, genetic similarity is high. We look very much like chimps, and we might be very similar genetically. Or not, depending on your point of view. I'm going to show you that in a second. The alternative is more interesting, is that morphological similarity is high, but the genetic similarity is low, or morphological similarity is low and genetic similarity is high. So the classic examples of high morphological similarity and low genetic similarity is what are called living fossils. Living fossils it's kind of a strange name, but it's those organisms that are alive with us. However, when you look at fossils of millions of years ago, the fossils look exactly the same as those organisms, meaning that it looks like over millions of years, morphologically, those organisms have not changed. Examples of that are coelacanths, for example, or horseshoe crabs. If you look at fossils of horseshoe crabs, they look exactly like the ones that you can see on the East Coast. If some of you are from the East Coast and have seen horseshoe crabs, you look at them and you say, whoa, these look really primitive. It is because they are. Now, when you do their genetics, when people first started doing molecular evolution on these guys, they said, oh, this is going to be great because we're going to have a glimpse of what molecules used to look like a long time ago because those things were so primitive. And in fact, their mutation rate and every characteristic of their molecules is exactly like everything else. So the molecular biology of those organisms is very, very diverse, but their morphology is very has been maintained over millions of years. Except for those very few genes that happen to encode for their external morphology. This is just a couple of dozen genes and that's it. So yes, for those genes, things have not changed very much because those guys are perfectly adapted to their environment. Everything else is exactly the same as everybody else. And so there is a decoupling between morphological and molecular evolution. The opposite is what I was arguing kind of, where you may or may not appreciate how similar or not we are. Pan and Homo are of low similarity morphologically, some people might argue, and instead we are very, very similar genetically. The distance between humans and chimps is less than between sibling species of Drosophila. In fact, if Drosophila were us, they would classify us as the same species. For example, in a sample of 11 proteins representing 1,200 amino acids, only 5 differ between humans and chimps.
the other six proteins are identical in primary structure. It means that the sequence of the protein is the same. And most proteins that have been sequenced exhibit no amino acid difference between us. In fact, there was a call for women to be fertilized with or to be implanted with chimp fetuses to see if they could give birth to chimps just to see if they were compatible. And there were a number of volunteers, but it was not approved by the FDA, which kind of surprised me because I thought it was a cool experiment. That's just me. I'm kidding. I'm against this kind of bestiality. I'm kidding. Tape and stuff. However, it's super cool. There was one case, I mean, there is a whole documentary of this chimp that was walking only on its hind legs and was originally in a circus. There's a whole story about it. And eventually they sequenced its genome because for the longest time they thought it was a hybrid. And in fact it wasn't. But when you look at the movies, there are movies of this chimp, it is a little bit disturbing because it looks just like a human. It's very, very strange.
Are the worms more closely related to humans than chimps?
I was under the impression they were the same.
It's a bit of a semantic thing. But bonobos are what some people also call pygmy chimps. They are not pygmy, they are actually large animal chimps.
They're also like more hairless.
Yeah, they are. I mean, they look a little bit like this. So I think that the tree looks something like this. So this is humans, this is bonobos, and these are chimps. And so, strictly speaking, if you really want to talk about genetic distance, this distance is actually shorter than this one. So if you have a phonetic stance on how you look at evolution, this is a little bit less distance, the bonobos. However, when people use cladistic concepts, this is a clade, and it is completely separate from humans. So some people have argued what you just said, but I mean, this is... There is an entire lecture on human evolution, and there are so many intervening clades between this and this. There are so many different branches. We're going to talk about that. But yeah, kind of. They are, I find, they are really, not disturbing is not the right word, but it does question our humanity in many respects. These are questions that are more philosophical than truly evolutionary. I'm not sure. So another thing that is somewhat characteristic that I've talked already a lot about is the molecular clock. So again, this was the molecular clock was discovered by Emil Zuckerkandel and Linus Pauling in 1962. Incidentally, this was the way it was discovered is actually really interesting. Emil Zuckerkandel comes from a very educated Jewish family from Vienna in Austria, and was essentially had to flee during the Second World War, and because of the Nazis just before the Second World War, and had to actually go to North Africa, and couldn't go to the university because he was Jewish. So the only thing that he could do was to learn piano, and became a very proficient concert player. But then he had a family friend in the United States, Albert Einstein, that got him a fellowship to study sciences in the United States, and got him in touch with Linus Pauling. And the two of them, actually mostly a new supercandle, came up with the idea of the molecular clock. a journal asked them to write a paper, actually it says in the book, they asked them to write a paper, and Pauline said, you know, I'm busy, just come up with anything. And took a gun and said, well, how about the idea of microbes? So the way they did it is that they looked at globin proteins and looked at how they diverged among pairs of organisms, and then saw, looked at the number of amino acid changes and see if there was a relationship between the distance between organisms and the number of changes in amino acids. And that's what they found. So they took homologous amino acid sequences from a group of taxa, they estimated the divergence times from the fossil record, and then they looked at the relationship between protein divergence and evolutionary time. And I've talked about it already many times, but this is now in the context of molecular evolution. So they took the alpha globins, invertebrates, time of millions of years, and they had this, this graph. Okay, that's fine. So molecular clocks are really useful to estimate divergence times. That's as far as the tool is concerned, it's very convenient. This I talked about it in the context, for example, in the very first lecture of HIV. That's what allowed us to determine when the HIV virus entered human populations, for example. It allows you to determine the divergence of extinct organisms. It allows you to assess the time divergence between organisms that do not have fossils, such as, for example, jellyfishes. Jellyfish do not fossilize very well, so the fossil record is very sketchy, and molecular clocks are very useful for that. That's one aspect of the molecular clock. Another aspect of the molecular clock that was discovered after the original paper by Zucker, Campbell, and Pauling was when people started sequencing DNA. When you sequence DNA, very quickly you notice a number of things. And this is a graph that is absolutely fundamental because it is the crux of what molecular evolution is. It looks very simple and it really isn't. On the x-axis, you have years of divergence between pairs of organisms. On the y-axis, you have the number of nucleotide substitutions. How many mutations there are that are observed. They are called substitutions. The blue line is the non-synonymous substitutions. This means that each time there's a mutation that changes an amino acid, it's a blue dot. When mutations occur in those areas of a protein coding gene that do not change the amino acid, you get a red dot. And as you can see, the two slopes are different. I already talked about it before, but this is a good time to reassess what this is. So, because mutations occur at the same rate anywhere, because mutations are a chemical thing, this means that, and most mutations are removed in the first place, this means that in the genome, you have mutations that happen all the time, and those mutations are cleaned by the repair machinery. Some of them are maintained in the population. And when they are maintained in the population, they either change the amino acid, that would be a blue dot, or they hit a thing that does not change the amino acid, that would be a red dot. And here, the impression is that there are more mutations in the red area than the blue area. This actually means two things. First, that those organisms that have as many mutations as the red dots in the blue area are dead. And so this is, most mutations are bad. I want to remember that most mutations are bad. That's the first observation. The other observation that is just as puzzling is that actually we can observe the red dots because they have been maintained in the population. So you have those mutations that actually have been maintained in the population in numbers large enough for you to even observe them. If they were so rare, what are the chances to actually sequence an organism that happens to have a mutation that is a red dot? And this is what random genetic variation is. This is not an easy concept. And such a simple graph, you to fully appreciate what this graph is, really takes several weeks or several months or maybe several years to fully understand what this graph is. And it's so simple, I could just very simply say, obviously, here you have amino acids, they are under selection, this is not under selection, there is more of it, and this one is less. Simple enough. Actually, it's not that simple, because this means that, yeah, that many individuals that died, this is the number of individuals that died, and these guys are actually individuals that have been kept by random chance, and this is why you actually can even see them in the first place. So, It is a very, very powerful graph. This is when the rates of silent substitution of the gene are compared to its rate of replacement substitution. So silent substitutions are the ones that do not change the amino acids. The replacement substitutions are the ones that change the amino acid. The former typically exceeds the latter by a factor of 5 to 10. So this difference in slope, it's like a change in mutation in substitution rate of 5 to 10. That's the ratio that you're observing. And I cannot stress this enough. This is not a mutation rate. This is actually the rate of substitutions that have not been removed by the repair machinery. So that is the number of actual mutations that occur in the genome is really difficult to estimate because most of them are fixed. Then after that, a certain number that we don't know actually is lethal and kills organisms, so we have no idea how many there are. And of those, then you have this red line. And then the ones that survive are the blue ones. The conclusion, the majority of evolution involves the substitution of silent mutations, likely by random drift. Another thing that is really important about this graph is that all of this area has never been really assessed by people that are interested in behavior, ecology, phenotype in general. Because this is not visible, it's not going to change the fitness of the organism. Yet most of the mutations are really important as far as evolution is concerned, and it's not visible. That's the realm of molecular evolution. Molecular evolution deals with a huge change in a genome that may or may not be fixed even, and is not visible. And so that's why there is an entire field that deals with molecules that is unrelated with the organisms. Then you would say, well, who cares? If it really doesn't change the fitness, who cares? And actually it does, because for the longest time, it's just going to change something that is not changing the fitness. And it's only a matter of time before the genome is so different that actually individuals cannot interbreed anymore. These observations led to the proposal of the nuclear theory of molecular evolution in 68 by Moto Kimura, the survival of the luckiest. This has nothing to do with fitness, it's a matter of mathematical sorting, as I described when I had this bag of red and white balls, and depending on the number of individuals, you may identify or sort some genotypes over others. There is one thing that I find really cool historically, I don't know if you are sensitive to that or not, but I am, and it's that when Tsukakano and Pauling in 62 came up with the molecular clock, when Kimura in 68 came up with the neutral theory of evolution, what is really great is that they had almost no data, yet their conclusions were correct. That's what is really fun. Darwin himself said, you know, anyone can come up with the correct answer if you have all the information. What is more interesting is to come up with the correct conclusion when you have almost no data. Those guys, they had literally fragments of proteins. They had next to nothing, and they came up with the right answers. So that's quite spectacular. Okay, so now we are going to go more into the neutral theory of evolution and how neutrality and selection balance each other. Go ahead. This one you mean?
No.
This one?
Yeah,
substitution of silent mutations by random variables. Yes? You would like me to develop that a little bit?
So
silent mutations, right? The evolution of the
genetic?
It's the opposite, actually. So this is what happens is, let me just say it again and then you tell me if I answer the question. You have two types of changes. There is one change that is a change that changes an amino acid. Let's say that this change in amino acid changes the fitness of the allele that is changed with that amino acid. So selection is going to operate, and this new allele, let's call this allele head with a star, is going to enter the population, and because the fitness of the organism that has this allele is higher, the frequency of this allele is going to increase. So that is simple enough. You have a mutation, changes the amino acid, there is natural selection, allele has a higher fitness, selection helps increase the frequency of that. That's how it enters the population. That is simple. Another thing is, if you have a change, it's an A goes into a G, for example, this does not change the fitness. And so the question is, why would this G would ever be visible and would be representing a lot of individuals here? How could it ever possibly become fixed? And so the only way for this to happen, and it can be visible and it becomes a red dot in that thing, is by drift. And drift is just a chance. So you have a bag of individuals, and all of them have A's. There are A's everywhere. And then there is a few individuals that have G's. And just by chance, those individuals are going into a new population. And those guys have G's, and that's why you see it. This is what random drift is. And so it's two very different pathways. In this one, you change the fitness, and by selection, you get this, and you get those blue dots. By drift, you get the red ones. And that's what it means, that's what this sentence is. The majority of evolution involves the substitution of silent mutations, like by random drift. And the reason why we say that is because the number of those red dots is much, much higher than this one. This one is really rare. Instead, the vast majority of changes that are observed between us, the majority of the differences between all of us are actually because of that. Not at all because of that. That's right. So yeah, he was a busy person. That's how he came up with it. In this 5:10 is the difference between alpha and beta. In the humeral 2-parameter model, that's the same person. Everybody remembers the alpha and beta stuff. When alpha equals beta, you are in the juice canton model. A few things about the neutral theory of evolution. So I'm going to go through some details that are kind of cool but not super important, and then some other things that seem to me a little bit more important that I will try to emphasize what I think is important and de-emphasize what is slightly less. There is a number of characteristics. Most mutations are harmful, and and thus removed by negative or purifying selection. The analogy that I have is about for example, ocean acidification. Ocean acidification is going to change the expression of genes in a number of organisms. And one thing that I find really interesting is that most of these changes are always bad. And I always said, how is it that it doesn't make it better? Like, why is it that global warming is not good? The reason why it's not good is because actually we are in a situation that is very, very well adapted. Because organisms are very well adapted to their environment, as soon as you change anything, the chances for the situation to be worse is much higher for the situation to be better. And that's the same for mutations. Because all our genes are so fine-tuned with the environment, when you have a mutation, we think, oh, a mutation is going to get better. Not really. Because we are so well adapted to our environment at all times, every time you have a mutation, almost always, that mutation is not going to make it any better. It's a little bit like the concept of you open the hood of your car, you're going to just throw a hammer at the engine. Sometimes it's going to fix it. Most of the time it's not. And that's the same idea. The engine is working just fine. If you throw a hammer in it, the most likely thing that's going to happen is that you're going to break that the engine. That's the same exact same idea. So most mutations are bad. And because the mutations are bad, the fitness is going to decrease. And when the fitness decreases, the individual is weeded out of the population. It's descendants, not the individual. In some cases, the individual. Most of the times, it's descendants. So it's what is called negative or purifying selection. The fitness of the individual is lowered, and the individual is usable. Some mutation, so sadly, we actually don't even know how much of it is present because most of these organisms are dead. That's kind of a good thing, you know, because you sometimes are a little bit worried about the situation, but if you have a mutation, it's going to be bad. But we don't know exactly how many individuals are involved in that situation because they are removed from the pool. Some mutations are neutral and thus accumulate in natural populations by random genetic drift. That's this situation here. And how much of it depends on how philosophically you look at life. Kimura thought that 99.9% of it is neutral, of course. Some people are a little bit more nuanced than that. Very rarely, beneficial mutations occur and are fixed by positive natural selection. That's the regular directional selection that we're used to, you know, out of a ton of individuals, some have mutations that are not making any difference in normal times. The environment changes, those individuals all of a sudden become, have a much higher fitness, and those mutations are kept in the next generations. The rate of evolution of a molecule is determined by its degree of functional constraint. This is another type of graph that I showed with the molecular clock, where the more selection there is, the less the slope of the molecular clock, because you cannot afford to change amino acids very much, otherwise you're going to lower the fitness. So that was the kind of predictions and observations of Kimura about the neutral theory of evolution. And finally, neutral mutations and random drift are responsible for virtually all molecular evolution. That's kind of a tautology because the definition of molecular evolution is what is not non-molecular evolution. So that's all what is essentially neutral. It's the kind of stuff that you're only able to see when you're doing molecular stuff. This theory gave rise to a bitter dispute known as the neutralist selectionist controversy. There is some of this happening in this very building, I won't name names. But there are some raving neutralists and raving selectionists. Instead, in this room, we are very calm and poised, and we understand that life is balanced. The controversy raged throughout the 70s and 80s and has not been satisfactorily resolved. to say the least. I have seen personally fistfights at meetings between the two factions, and it's extremely entertaining, especially towards the end of the meetings where the booze is free. The essence of the controversy is not whether natural selection or random genetic drift operates at the macro level, but rather what is the relative importance of each. Testing the validity of the neutral theory has been very difficult.
Let me see if I can explain why this is. You say, scientists are reasonable people, just as much as everybody else, not more, not less. And they are going to be convinced by evidence. The problem is that the evidence is nearly impossible to gather. That's why people have not been able to reach a consensus, because